Now again, I'm okay. Didn't have an accident, but I came pretty close. G'day guys, Jason here. Welcome back to my fish room. So in this week's video, I'm gonna be telling you guys a bit of a story about the drama that I had when I picked up the sump from my tank manufacturer. That sump's gonna be put onto this side of the fish room wall, but something happened along the way that I wanted to share with you guys because I really can't believe what happened, but thankfully I'm okay. So let's get into this week's video. So guys, you can see us loading the tank into the back of my ute here and everything is going fine. I'm packing the tank into the back of the ute, tying it all up, putting some styrofoam around it just to make sure it's secure if I was to have to brake suddenly or turn suddenly in the unlikely event of an accident. Now again, I'm okay. Didn't have an accident, but I came pretty close. So I was driving home, being extra cautious, not to, you know, suddenly slam on the brakes or have to turn harshly anywhere, just taking my time because the tank is fragile, obviously. And I hear what I can only describe as a helicopter overhead. So I genuinely thought there was a helicopter flying very low to the highway and that it was about to pass us overhead. So I was looking through, you know, the rearview mirrors, looking in my rearview mirror and my side mirrors going, where is this helicopter? Why won't it pass us? And I realized that sound is coming from my ute. Something's wrong. Although the vehicle steering didn't feel any different. It was just the sound of the vehicle that was different. But I only heard this sound for about 5 to 10 seconds, but that is a long time when you're traveling at 100 kilometers an hour with a fish tank in the back tray. Suddenly I heard a loud bang. And I saw in my side mirror on the driver's side window, debris coming off the back tire. The tire exploded. I just couldn't believe it. Of all trips, luckily I was in the slow lane. I was able to veer off the road, control the vehicle, go into the shoulder, and then stop the vehicle there. And then obviously called the traffic authorities for them to come out and hopefully slow down the traffic, because this highway, the speed limit is 110 kilometers an hour. There was no way I was going to be able to change the tire that close to the road with vehicles traveling that fast past me. So being pulled over to the shoulder is quite a risky thing to do, but I had no other option. Thankfully, they were able to see me on the camera while I was talking to them on the phone, and I was only on the side of the road for about 20 minutes. The guys were fantastic. They had the proper machinery, obviously, to just quickly change a tire. They actually closed one of the lanes and slowed the traffic to approximately 40 k's an hour while they were able to change the tire out very quickly for me with all their tools, rather than me using the jack that comes with the car, for instance. And then I was able to put that busted tire in my back seat. But then the guys were like, just put that busted tire in the tray. And I'm like, no, guys, I've actually got an aquarium in the tray. I can't believe this has happened on all days, on all journeys with this car. It's the first time I've had a blowout like that on that vehicle, or any vehicle for that matter. And it just so happened to be the day that I had an aquarium in the back. What are the chances? Just crazy. I had an old tarpaulin actually in the back seat from the tray that I had moved out to make way for the aquarium. So I just sat that busted tire on top of the tarp, so the seat upholstery was protected, and I very carefully drove home. And I was really relieved once I got home, as you can imagine, because that was quite a harrowing experience. And I'm just going to play some footage for you here now when I got home of my reaction to seeing the tire properly for the first time and inspecting the tank.
So here's the tire, guys. Pretty crazy. It's torn all the way around. Mental. So lucky. And there's the spare, obviously. You can see where debris from the tire when it exploded has hit the car. And here's the tank. I can't believe it has stayed in one piece. It's incredible. It didn't move with all of that. I was able to safely slow down and pull over, and it's in one piece, no cracks. Just so lucky, had it tied down just the right amount of styrofoam on the sides, and yeah, even something as violent as
the tire exploding on all days today. The tank was fine. Again, there's the tire. So lucky. Okay guys, and here's the sump. It's in one piece, thankfully. There are no cracks. Obviously I haven't tested it for leaks yet. I've just brought it inside to the fish room and I've placed it here for the time being because I still need to move some tanks out of the way where the sump will eventually sit. The tanks at the moment have bristlenose catfish in them. They're gonna be moved out. I'll drain those tanks. Those tanks will be taken out of position and then I'll move the sump into its final position, ready to be plumbed up to this side of the fish room wall. So I'm really relieved, obviously, that it got home in one piece after that ordeal on the road. So now I just need to clean up the sump, give it a bit of a wipe down, move it in position, fill it up, test it for leaks. But the sump length is 4 foot long by 45 centimeters wide by 50 centimeters high. So more than enough for the amount of tanks I'm gonna have running on this sump. In case of a blackout, it won't overflow. So, and you can see there are no bulkheads drilled into the sides of this sump. I'm gonna be doing a very simple sump design with all the tanks draining to this sump via gravity over the top, over the lip of the sump. I could have gone obviously higher, making the sump a larger volume of water, but then I would have had to work out ahead of time where I am going to have the plumbing that doesn't exist yet on the sump. So because the tanks are gonna be draining from both sides of the sump, I just wanted it simple. Otherwise I could have had all the holes on one side of the sump, say here, but because I'm gonna have the 5 foot tanks draining in from this side, I didn't wanna have the tank drilled on this side as well as this side of the sump. So it's just simple design. Tanks will just drain into the sump, into this chamber, which will have the mechanical filtration, just some sponges. We'll go down up this bubble trap into this chamber, which will have biological filtration, down through the bubble trap up here, and then into the return pump chamber, where I'll also have some heaters for backup. And I'm gonna be transferring some media into this sump once the plumbing is all done on this side of the fish room, and then it will be seated, ready to go. I won't have to worry about a cycle happening on this sump because I'm moving over biological media from this sump into here straight off the bat. So it'll be a very easy transition for this side of the fish room to run on the sump. So there you have it, guys. The sump is in the fish room. I'm okay, the sump is fine, and I'm just grateful that everything turned out as best as it could. But yeah, there you go, a bit of drama with getting that sump home. I hope you enjoyed that video, a little bit different, but if you did, please give me a thumbs up, comment, and consider subscribing to the channel. I really would appreciate it. But all right, guys, I'm gonna wrap this video up now. Thanks heaps for watching, and I'll catch you in the next one. Bye.